past few weeks, we have been in a series on the life of Samson. We're going to take a break just today from that. I'm going to preach on something different this morning, and then we'll pick back up with Samson, Lord willing, next Sunday. But I have to say, at the beginning of this lesson, how would you feel if I looked at all of you and said, you are nothing but a bunch of weird people? All of you. All of you are just some weird people. Christians are. We are weird. We're just plain weird. Those words are said behind our back more times than I think we would like to believe. And probably they're thought more times than they're ever articulated and said to us. And I think we need to face the facts. From the world's point of view, from the world's perspective, Christians are an unusual bunch of people. We are different. We are strange. Sometimes people in the world think that we're just absolutely crazy. And if you're in touch with the world, and you're in touch with those who are out of touch with God on a regular basis, then you have heard the opinion voiced by them, I'm sure, many times. And in some cases, when others find out that you're a believer, when they find out that you're a Christian, all of a sudden they kind of get defensive. And they get this defensive posture, and they become uneasy, and then they start to try to avoid you. Or maybe they say something like, you know, don't lay that religious stuff on me. It's interesting what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 2 and in verse 9. Look there, if you will, at 1 Peter chapter 2 and in verse 9. Peter writes and he says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his possession, so that you may proclaim the praises of the one who called you out of darkness into this marvelous light." The King James Version renders that a peculiar people. A peculiar people. And we seem that way to the people of the world. We seem like a peculiar people. In verse 11, he says, "Dear friends, I urge you as strangers and exiles to abstain from sinful desires that wage war against the soul." Again, some translations use the word alien. Aliens. And I don't know what you think of when you think about the word alien, but, you know, I think of the whole UFO somewhere, and some creature gets out, and there's this big old green head with two big eyes, and it's just weird looking, right? Alien. Peter says the Christians sometimes are aliens to the world. And there is a sense in which we appear exactly that way to people who know nothing about God. Our way of life is the opposite of the way most people actually live. Here we come together and we sing and we worship someone that we cannot even see. And we empty ourselves so that we can be full. We do an odd thing. We admit that we're wrong so that we can be right. We're strongest when we are the weakest. We forsake in order to have. We give away so that we can keep. We step down to step up. We put others first above ourselves. We die so that we can live. And I tell you, it is a mixed up way of life to people who don't know anything about God. And if that weren't enough, think about our behavior. We refrain from taking God's name in vain. We don't go out and get liquored up at the bars like other people do. We get off of work, and Christians do a very odd thing when they get off of work. You know what they do? They go home to their families. That's a weird thing to do. And come Sunday, we go to church. We go to church on Sunday. We even go on Wednesday night to a Bible study. That's really odd to a lot of people. We read our Bible and we pray every day. Christians are different. If you look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 3 and 4, for there has already been enough time spent in doing what the Gentiles choose to do, carrying on in unrestrained behavior, evil desires, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and lawless idolatry. They are surprised that you don't join them in the same flood of wild living, and they slander you. That is, they make fun of you. They ridicule you. Why? Because you appear as an alien to them. You appear odd and strange to them. And the truth of the matter is, the stronger that you become as a Christian, the stranger you will become to them. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 11, Jesus said, "Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me." Now, if that's not happening sometimes in our lives, if we look back and we say, "Nope, that doesn't happen to me. It doesn't happen to me at all," then maybe we need to reevaluate our commitment to Christ. And if it is happening, well, if it is happening, you can know that you're in some pretty good company. You're in very good company. Look at the book of Mark, chapter 3. In Mark, chapter 3, there is a homecoming. Jesus came home. He comes back to Nazareth. And in Mark chapter 3, beginning in verse 20, Jesus entered a house, and the crowd gathered again so that they were not even able to eat. When his family heard this, they sent out to restrain him because they said, "He's out of his mind. He's out of his mind." Imagine this scene as Jesus comes back to Nazareth. He comes back to his hometown, and there's this multitude of people around him, and there's this buzz, there's this excitement around him. And yet the townspeople could not believe what was going on. Matthew says in Matthew chapter 13 and verse 55 that they were saying, "Is this not the carpenter's son? We know this kid. That's the carpenter's son." They remembered Jesus as being Joseph's son. And here are these people that are coming with him, and they're talking about all the miracles, and they're saying, "Messiah? I knew this kid when he was knee-high. You're telling me he's the Messiah?" The townspeople who, again, had seen him grow up could not comprehend that. They couldn't comprehend that. Again, isn't that the little boy who I used to see playing in the streets? Isn't that the little boy who used to come over to my house and play? Isn't that the little boy who used to hang out by the carpentry shop? What are you talking about, Messiah? You've got to be kidding me. They didn't believe it. They did not believe it. They looked upon Jesus as being deluded. Some of his own family members, did you catch that? Some of his own family members said, "He's lost his mind. He's crazy." As time went on, it didn't get any better. He was crucified by his enemies. His followers gathered around and they claimed and preached resurrection. And they formed such a formidable group that they impacted the entire Roman Empire. And a major spokesman for what was called the Way was a turncoat Jew named Saul of Tarsus. And in Acts chapter 2 and verse 20, or Acts chapter 26, he's on trial and facing a politician by the name of Festus. And in verse 24, Festus interrupts Paul while Paul was preaching to Festus, telling him why he was a Christian and a believer in Christ. And Festus says this. He says, "Paul, you are out of your mind. Your great learning is driving you mad. You're crazy. You are a crazy man, Paul. You're nuts." And that's still said today. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12, "Indeed, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. If you're going to be a believer in Christ, there are going to be verbal jabs. There's going to be things said about you, and there's going to be jokes and snide remarks. There's going to be people who look at you and say things like, oh, you just think that you're holier than the rest of us. That's all it is. It's interesting to me to study the times, how we pride ourselves in America today, in the 21st century, the word tolerance. Tolerance. We are so politically correct. We are tolerant of everybody. Everybody. From the media to academia, people view Christians on equal footing with the Nazis, the KKK, all sorts of those groups. And again, it's funny how we're tolerant of every group of people except for one. There doesn't seem to be much toleration for people who believe in this book. Tolerate everyone except if you believe in this book. We can't tolerate that. We've got to get rid of that. Again, people like you and I are equated with some evil people and evil groups in this world. It was the wonderful philosopher Rosie O'Donnell who said radical Christians are as threatening as radical Islam. And by radical Christians, you know who she meant? You. She meant you and me. That's what she meant. And it's interesting that when somebody takes a stand publicly and they take a stand in favor of God, or they take a stand in definition of morality, or they defend the Bible, all of a sudden they're labeled as a right-wing religious fundamentalist wacko. That's it. We're nuts. We're crazy. But is that really any different from the way that it's always been? We shouldn't be surprised. From the ridicule they gave to Jesus or the ridicule they gave to Paul, you know, sometimes it just goes with the territory. It's always been this way. Now maybe we need to take a time out and say for the sake of balance that there are some Christians who, in my estimation, do get a little weird. They do. Some people are so strange, I think that I would probably have to agree with their critics. And there's an old saying that if everybody thinks you're nuts, then you must be, right? If everybody thinks you're nuts, you must be. But I'm not talking about those people. I'm not talking about those people this morning. I'm not talking about people who are out of touch when it comes to living in the real world. I'm talking about balanced people. People who have a deep faith and a deep commitment in Jesus Christ and a genuine faith. A genuine faith. That's who I'm talking about. These are people who live in the world, but they have made the conscious decision that I am not going to let the world live inside of me. That's who I'm talking about. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul addresses the question of why we are so misunderstood. And he zeroes in and he gives four reasons why Christians are misunderstood. Now, before I give you those four reasons from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I want you to keep two things in mind. Number one, we don't solve the problem by being two-faced. Some Christians, I'm afraid, are so bothered by the fact that they might be misunderstood or labeled or laughed at or looked upon by their peer group as being different, and so they go to great lengths to try to hide who they really are. And all of a sudden, the Christian becomes like someone who is in the witness protection program. We need to hide and not let anybody know who we are. And that goes against everything that Scripture tells us to do. You remember when you were a child in your Sunday school class and you sang that song about your little light and hiding it under a bush? As a little child, what did we learn? When we said to hide it under a bush, what was the next word? No. No. We don't do that. Because Jesus said, let your light shine among men that they may see your good works. So we don't solve any problems by being two-faced and by hiding. And the second thing is we don't solve the problem by going along just to get along with everybody. Peer pressure. We talk about peer pressure often in relation to young people, but it's true of any age. It really is. It becomes easy to become a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It's easy to be a Christian on Sunday and then be like everybody else on Monday and throughout the rest of the week. It's easier to compromise. It's so much easier to compromise than to be a man or woman of conviction. We can't do that. We have to be a man or a woman of conviction. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I picked a verse that says exactly what I'm saying this morning. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the beginning of verse 13. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the very beginning of verse 13. For if we are out of our mind, it is for God. If we are out of our mind, it is for God. Why would anyone think that he was crazy? Why? Why would anyone think that we're crazy? Well, as I said, let me give you four reasons. Number one, because our mission is absolutely unique in this world. It really is. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, in verse 9 through 11, it says, therefore, whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to be pleasing to him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may be repaid for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, since we know the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade people. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your consciences. Now, that's not exactly the mission of the world. That's not the mission of the world at all. That's not exactly the motto of society. The motto of society is live and let live. The motto of society is I'm okay, you're okay, we're all okay. Let's be tolerant of different beliefs, and let's be tolerant of different behaviors, even tolerant of different sexual preferences. And if a person isn't tolerant of those things, then you're the problem. You're the problem. And you need sensitivity training. But I want you to notice what Paul said. He says in verse 9, because our goal is to live to please God. He says in verse 10, because we know there is a coming day of judgment. And because, he says in verse 11, we live in fear, that is respect of God's holiness and God's power. And so therefore, he says in verse 11, we persuade men. The word persuade there means to win over with words. To win over with words. You know, there comes a time when our objective is obviously not to beat somebody over the head with the Bible. Our objective is not to force a hearing. Our objective is to build bridges and not tear them down. But there comes a time when not only must we persuade with our life and persuade by our day-to-day example, but there comes a time in our lives when God swings open the door of opportunity and we must persuade men with words. The Bible says that there is a time to speak and there is a time to be silent. And sometimes we get that backwards. When was the last time you had the courage to say what you knew needed to be said at that moment, even though it wasn't easy to do it? Yes, I really do mind if you use that language. Yes, I think that homosexuality is a sin before God. I'm sorry to disagree with you, but I believe that abortion is the wrong thing. No, I don't think that just because your husband had an affair that you ought to be able to go have one yourself. You know, we would love to get with you all on Sundays, But we appreciate the invitation to go camping with you on Saturday night into Sunday, but worship is very important to our family, and we worship on Sundays. I really don't want you drinking around my kids. Yeah, I think that the supervisor wasn't fair and that wasn't right what they did to you, but you know what? Cussing him out isn't going to do you any good. Is it possible, ladies and gentlemen, that when opportunities present themselves, is it possible to persuade with words without being overly obnoxious? I know some Christians who don't have any tact when it comes to dealing with people in the world. It's almost like they go out of their way and they wear a badge of honor to see how offensive that they can possibly be. And I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the need for all of us, on different occasions, to have the courage to say what needs to be said. Again, as a young child, hide it under a bushel? No. Have the courage to say what needs to be said. We sing about it. Stand up for Jesus. You understand that song and many other songs that talk about standing have absolutely nothing to do with our posture in the church assembly. It has to do with standing up for what is right. Standing up for what is right on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. Paul said, therefore, we persuade men. You say sometimes what needs to be said and you say it in a good way, and there's going to be people who are going to think you're crazy. They will. But Paul said in verse 13, if we're crazy, it is for God. And occasionally, you may find somebody who will listen, who will appreciate your stand. Secondly, our whole approach to life is different. In verse 14, Christ, look at verse 14. Verse 14, for the love of Christ compels us, since we have reached this conclusion that one died for all. The love of Christ is what controls us. That is our whole motivation. The compelling force that motivates us to be different. The compelling force that gives us the courage to say sometimes what needs to be said is that love for Christ. And what does his love motivate us to do? Persuade about what? In verse 15, it says he died for all so that all who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. That is our mission. That is our whole approach to life. Now that's a crazy message to some people. Their motto is looking out for number one. You tell people that Jesus is number one, or you tell people that the Lord is the priority in your life, and they're going to roll their eyes and they're going to look at you like you're funny, because they're going to think you're crazy. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that we preach Christ crucified. And he said that to the world, that is foolishness. But he said to us that who are being saved, it is the power of God. And so our mission is different. Our whole approach to life is different. Third, our whole perspective is different. When you look at verse 16, from now on, then, we do not know anyone from a worldly perspective. Even if we have known Christ from a worldly perspective, yet now we no longer know him in this way. Now you tell me how the world judges anybody. The world judges exactly by the flesh. The world judges by the flesh. That's how they judge everything. That's why we put so much emphasis on looks. Now, I'm a sign reader. Anytime I'm driving, I see a sign, I have to read it. And I always look at different billboards, and I'm always looking for the ones that are odd and different. And I'll never forget, I was out in California, And I saw a sign, and it said, tattoos, tanning beds, and fudge. I had to look at that twice. Tattoos, tanning beds, and fudge. And I just thought, well, I guess if you're going to get a tattoo or you're going to go to the tanning bed, you might as well get fat at the same time and eat some fudge. I guess that's what they were getting at. I don't know, but that's our whole society. It's all about the flesh. Everything is about the flesh. Now, I'm not saying as a Christian that we should let ourselves go or we run off in some extreme. That's not what I'm saying. But yet, sometimes we face difficult situations and decisions. And those of us who raise kids, understand this, especially those who raise girls. If you raise a girl, you know the hardship of going out to the stores and buying clothing for your girls that are decent. It's not driven by sex appeal. And those sexy clothes start showing up as early as 4, 5, and 6 years old. The big thing for Halloween, I don't know if you knew this, the big thing for Halloween for little girls were the sexy outfits. For little girls. That was very popular. And you see little kids oftentimes with these low jeans and revealing tops, and you think, well, where's all this going to go? And wording with all kind of sexual innuendos. And I'm thinking, where's Dad in all of this? Where's Mom in all of this? Don't go there. Don't start there. But what that says is when it comes to parents, it's hard. It is hard raising our kids in a world that is so different from the way that we should think. It's not easy. And so we have to raise our children and help them understand that you cannot wear what everybody else wears. You can't do what everybody else does. You can't say what everybody else says. You can't do that. Our whole perspective is distinct. It must be different. And that places us out of step with culture. And when that happens, people look at us and they say, you're crazy. What do you mean you're not giving your 5-year-old a cell phone? You're nuts. You're crazy. What do you mean you don't want your daughter to wear these new these jeans that barely cover themselves? You're crazy. That's what everybody's doing. Again, they're going to look at you like you're nuts. Finally, verse 17, our whole life is transformed. In verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. People who become a Christian are not people who just turn over a new leaf. Becoming a Christian is not like making a New Year's resolution. It is a transformation. A transformation. It is becoming a brand new creation. Romans chapter 12 and verse 2 says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed, changed. And when you become a Christian, you need to change. You have to change. The old things must pass away, and so your life is different. You've got new habits. The old ones are gone. The old speech patterns are gone. The old way of dressing is gone. The old attitudes are gone. And they're replaced by a new way of thinking. Old things have passed away, and new things have come. And so now you become a Christian. After living in the world and in a society, and then you try and explain to your friends that you've changed your life, you know what's going to happen? They're going to think you're crazy. They may not say it right up to your face at first, but they'll probably think it. You're crazy. They're going to think that you're an alien because you become a living testimony of the power of the gospel. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16 says it is the power to save. And it has the power to change the roughest of people, into devoted followers of Jesus Christ. And some of you know exactly how that works. Because a few years ago, for some of you, a few years ago, if somebody had told you that you would be sitting in an assembly with your Bible open and studying and singing hymns, you would have said to them, you're crazy. Ain't gonna happen. And here you are. And here you sit with your Bible open. That is the power of the gospel. And so our message to others is a simple one. I used to be like you. I used to talk that way and dress that way. And I used to have those habits and I used to go there and I used to do that. But God changed my life and God has given me hope. And I want that for you and I want that for your family. I'd like for you to know the joy of serving Jesus like I do. There's no greater demonstration of the power of God than changed lives. And when we change and live as we live, the people around us, they may get uncomfortable. They may think we're strange. They may think we're weird. They may think we're crazy. But then again, as Paul said, we're not living to please them anyway. Who cares if they think we're crazy? Who cares if they think we're weird? We're not living for them. We are living to please God. Paul said that if we are crazy, then we are crazy for God. May we have that same disposition. If you're here this morning and you've not yet rendered obedience to the gospel of Christ, you may have people in your life telling you that that's a crazy thing to do. You don't need to be around those crazy people. Stay away from those people. They're nuts. They're crazy. Let them talk. Let them say that. They've been saying it since the very beginning. They're going to continue to say it until the very end of time. Christians will always be considered crazy. So what? We live to please God. And God would be pleased if you were to respond to the gospel, to recognize the sin in your life, to confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and be baptized into Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. That's what pleases God. And for those of us who have done that, God knows that we're a flawed people. He knows that we will sin, but it pleases Him when those of us who sin repent, turn from those sins, and ask Him to forgive us, and He has promised to forgive us of those sins. If you have a need, we ask that you make it known right now as together we stand and sing the invitation song.